Yeah, morning, Jagriti.
Morning.
How are you? All set for your what is the date of your interview?
10th of September, sir.
Oh, so you have got just not too much of time, no?
Yes, sir.
Not very much of time. So you have specialized in electrical engineering and you worked for 2 years in BHEL, you know?
Yes, sir.
2 years you were there. What were you doing? Can you tell us a little bit about your experience in a public sector and you know?
Sir, in 2 years, first year was spent in training and induction program. And in the when I was permanently posted there, I worked as a purchase executive in material management for Transformers division.
I see. And what is your general view? Because you know these were all the Navratnas. What is your view of the public sector, and are they really useful now with all the disinvestment going on? Have they lost their utility? Is it better to go in for public-private partnership, monetize them, get the money for other development things, or is are they worth continuing in a limited way? What is your take on this whole public sector management and policy in India as a young executive?
Sir, in my opinion, public sectors and strategic sectors which fulfill certain strategic national interests should be retained in public sector, like Rural Electrification Corporation. They have a social interest in them. So further, in other sectors, as the government has said that we will retain bare minimum so that national interest dimension can be taken care of. Thus, we can have disinvestment, we can invite private participation to improve our rate of return on investment. Our private sectors have immense capacity, so we need to improve its utilization. And I think privatization can help us leverage that. Also, there will be challenges which we will have to address in that disinvestment.
I see. And what about what are the main motivations for you? Which attempt is this? Which attempt is this? Is this your second
This is
attempt?
my second attempt, sir.
Yeah, this is your second attempt. So, what is the motivation for you to join the civil service? You are an engineer. BHEL is a good public sector job. And what are the motivations? And what do you foresee your role as an IAS officer, and what do you think you can make a difference given your background?
So my experiences at BHEL Bhopal gave me a better exposure to these public services in general. They offer us a platform to participate in decision making and to be a direct part of inclusive development in the country. They have a very diverse scope of their functioning. So all the sectors I will be able to touch with my services in the sector. So further, with my knowledge of electrical engineering and engineering in general, I'll have a scientific attitude. I can also work with the engineering related sectors or power related sectors in general, because the government is also focusing upon specialization nowadays. So I think my specialization can I can specifically contribute even in those sectors as well, sir.
Okay. Now, you know, I want to ask you about this long pending and this vexed question of this women's reservation bill. It's been going on and on. Everybody seems to be for it, but it's not being passed. What exactly is happening? I mean, or is it at all required? Is it really fair to the women to have a reservation in parliament on their own? We've had such women leaders who've come up. Is it required or is it not? And why is it? What is this whole game that's going on in the name of this women's reservation bill?
Sir, women contribute towards half of the population of the country, yet their political participation, especially at the central legislation level, it is very meager, around 17%. Such reservations will ensure that women compulsorily form that at least 33%, as it is being proposed. At least that much participation will be guaranteed statutorily. But at the same time, such reservation will not be able to address the grassroots challenges because of which women have not been able to enter the political arena. So we will also have to address those challenges parallelly.
Okay. One last question on the civil services reform. You know, now from the Prime Minister onwards, everybody is very worried about the quality, the lack of motivation, the lack of delivery of the civil servants. You would have heard about it. So now there is a new scheme, So can you tell me about this new scheme that has come in, you know, this whole thing about, you know, that has come? Yeah. Could you tell me about it, please?
Sir, our scheme Mission Karmayogi has been launched by the government in order to redesign our civil services structure to meet the changing needs of the government, or the changing needs of governance, to be specific. They are moving from rules-based to roles-based approach. More ground-level training is being emphasized. Regular updation of knowledge with respect to technological upgradations and training for different kind of advancements that take place in the country. So it is envisaged to have a more dynamic system of public service in the country.
What I would suggest to you is, you know, this is very important. And this is a question that almost all these UPSC members will ask you, because it is very current and very worrisome about the quality of the civil servants. What I would suggest to you is, you must be knowing something about this. You should thoroughly go into the DOPT website. There is a PowerPoint presentation about 18 or 20 points there on this whole Mission Karmayogi. What is it wanting to achieve? Various, you know, online training. It's all there. So, you know, a question like this comes, you have to crack it. Yes. You know, you have to give the this thing that you know this thoroughly. So just an advice, you just go through it. And this is very useful, and you know, it'll be important. Yes, I will hand it over to Professor Narasimhan now to take charge, please.
Thank you, sir. You have studied sociology as one of your options, right?
Yes, sir.
Sociology. Okay. So, in sociology, generally, when people analyze the artifacts, they talk about two categories, ethic and emic categories. Have you heard of these things? What is ethic and what is emic?
Sir, I'm unable to recall these terms, sir.
No?
Sir, could you please repeat it once again?
Ethic and emic. ETIC and EMIC.
Sir, I'm unable to recall it, sir.
These are very two sociological and anthropological terms. It's also probably used by anthropologists and also by sociologists. These two categories are very important when you look at the cultures. Like, for example, a cultural artifacts. A particular culture has a number of artifacts. So how do you probably categorize them? And that's when these two categories come into play. Okay. And I think you can read about this.
I read on that.
It's not right. Okay. Okay. Right. And as a person from sociology, at least taken as optional sociology, how do you use your training or your knowledge in sociology to address a social tension in an area where you're going to work?
Sir, my knowledge of sociology has given me information about various background of social tensions that exist today. So with that knowledge of background and the current dynamics, so I'll be able to utilize that knowledge. Also, sociology does not hold any prejudices towards any community. The study is based upon, the study is done in a very scientific manner. So such study would help me placate both the sections where tension is going on. So I think without any prejudices, I'll be able to handle the case on its merit and be able to focus on these tensions.
Okay. As a sociologist, how do you define culture?
Sir, culture is the set of practices sanctioned within a particular religion, which frames the overall lifestyle of a particular community or a religious sect or denomination.
It is related to religion only, or is it a social thing?
Sir, it is a social and geographical concept, but usually tied with religious values and notions.
Not always. See, you talk about, for example, I don't know what you talk about in Madhya Pradesh, but here we talk about Tamil culture and people talk about American culture. It's not always tied to a religion. It is something else.
Yes, sir. I agree.
Religion is also part of culture. Religion also included in the culture. it's not culture is not nested in the religion, but whereas religion is nested in the culture.
Yes, sir. I would like to correct myself. And yes, culture develops on its own based on social, geographical, and religion plays just a part of it. Okay. I agree with that, sir.
Yes. And being a sociology student, you must also understand what is known as ethnocentrism. Have you come across this term?
Yes, sir.
That is very often that ethnocentrism is the major problem between the administrators and the common people.
Yes, sir. Ethnocentrism is one where one's allegiance to her ethnic identity is more important than one's allegiance to a wider national community or a wider community.
Okay. I think the more simpler is you judge based on your ethnic identity, the others. Right? That is actually the problem in many of the cases when you deal with from lower level to higher level administration, anywhere, not only here, right? Even in the US, it's the same issue, developed countries like US and other places. Okay.
Yes.
And Madhya Pradesh is also a tribal rich state.
Yes, sir.
Right. In fact, that's one of the richest state in India, a tribal population. And how do you address the issues of tribal in terms of modern development?
The tribal population in Madhya Pradesh in Madhya Pradesh in general or all the tribal populations?
No, in general, because you come from Madhya Pradesh, you should know your state situation.
No, sir, tribal population in Madhya Pradesh is not homogeneous. We need specific plans for specific tribal groups. Some have been sufficiently modernized, like Rajgons in Madhya Pradesh. They have political presentation. Their literacy levels are better. So there we need to integrate them with more technological advancements where they are lacking. Others like Saharia and Saur, especially those who constitute particularly vulnerable tribal groups, we will have to work upon even the grassroots situations like education, health, and then creating a niche for them in technological advancements at the local level itself. We can introduce technology for minor forest produce so that they gradually integrate with mainstream. So we'll have to take different approaches for different groups.
Please correct yourself. The term minor forest produce is not currently in vogue. They are called non-timber forest producers.
Yes, sir. Non-timber forest producers.
So it's an old British term, but they are no more minor now. They are the major revenue source for any of the forest department.
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Mrs. Zarina, please.
Jagriti, what's the progress of the scheme Swachh Sarvekshan, which has been implemented across the country? What's been the progress?
Ma'am, Swachh Sarvekshan judges the different districts in the country based on their performance in Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. And they allot a status like ODF status, ODF plus status. In ODF, various studies suggest that around 80% of the country has attained this ODF status. But ODF plus status or ODF double plus status, which also encompasses...
What is this ODF?
Open defecation free, that is ODF, is about presence of toilets for all households and in public utilities. And those are used regularly by the people. While we talk about ODF plus, it also involves the management of that waste, which is produced by the sanitary facilities. And ODF double plus goes a further way in also addressing the challenges around water management in these areas. Mm-hmm. So ma'am, ODF, we have been successful, but for ODF plus and ODF double plus, still only few districts have achieved those status.
Any significant outcomes which the survey has provided us with respect to Madhya Pradesh performance?
Madhya Pradesh has been always there in the top 10, with Indore having the first position for straight 3 years. Recently, I think it went to second position. Bhopal has also been there in top 10. So Madhya Pradesh has been doing fairly well in Swachh Bharat Abhiyan.
Indore, is it not the first ranked city?
Ma'am, I think in the latest survey, it slipped to second position.
Okay. So what is the benefits which we as different urban local bodies across the country have to learn from this drink from tap mission, which Puri has successfully implemented? Are you aware of it?
Ma'am, I'll have to read on that.
I think last week, the Vice President of US had a very surprise visit, I think I could say, to Southeast Asia. So what's the significance of her visit, and what's been the itinerary to be discussed about?
As USA is leaving Afghanistan, now they have started correcting their, they have started diverting their attention towards Southeast and Indo-Pacific, and also reiterating itself as global leader by projecting itself as a guarantor of rules-based order in the Indo-Pacific, especially against Chinese aggression. So in South China Sea dispute, it has said that it will stand up with various countries against any kind of imperialistic outreaches of China. So it is an effort to reassert the global leadership status that US enjoys.
Okay. I think you have your engineering background and the experience at Bell. Have you ever thought of what's the kind of emission and the effluence which the sector, as per se the electronic industry or a particular industry as such, is contributing to the environmental degradation?
Ma'am, electronics industry?
Yes.
Ma'am, electronics industry, with respect to emissions, they are power intensive. So usually the thermal power which is supplied is consumed by them. Ma'am, further, environmentally, they use many kind of metals and minerals in their processing, which are not treated before they are discharged. So these two issues need to be handled. Ma'am, electronic industry in general is a low power industry. So although manufacturing has a lot of power intensive operations, the output as such are not polluting in their nature. So the processing has to be tackled for electronics industry.
Okay. For any kind of any facts related to lead and arsenic, have you come across any significant discussions related to lead and arsenic, which we should be concerned about, or we should be
concentration of arsenic has been found beyond the normal tolerable levels, especially in Uttar Pradesh, Bihar and West Bengal region, while lead concentrations have also increased in the groundwater and surface water as well. So this is now entering food chains, as this water is utilized for irrigation and for drinking water purposes, which has a health impacts upon the community.
Is there any act which concerns specifically about lead and arsenic?
Ma'am, I can take a guess, but I'm not sure about that.
Yeah.
Is it Environmental Protection Act?
No. Resource Conservation and Recovery Act.
Ma'am, I agree.
It's okay. Yes,
ma'am.
Okay. I'm done, sir. Mr. Pandey Raj, I think you can continue.
Yes.
One Raj, please, guys.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Ms. Jaffrey, like, seems like you are interested in music, especially the Bundelkhandi music. Like, can you please elaborate on the evolution of the music? How are you attracted towards that music?
Sir, will you please pardon?
Okay. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir. Sir, little louder, sir.
I could see you are interested in Bundelkhandi music, actually. Like, can you please elaborate on the evolution of that particular stream of music and what attracted you towards that music?
Sir, the evolution of music is traced to the evolution of various dialects in the 15th-16th century. One stream of Brij Bhasha developed into Bundelkhandi in the region of Bundelkhand in Madhya Pradesh and Uttar Pradesh. The Bundela Rajput rulers of the region patronized this music and various local communities contributed to it. Certain writers like Ishwari and Jagnik, they have also contributed towards its evolution. Today, it is a source of great sociological knowledge about the region as it solely deals with the social issues.
What attracted you towards that music?
Sir, I was born in that region of Bundelkhand. So ever since my childhood, I have heard it. And as I said that it has a lot of social issues attached to it, especially regarding women. So it is a great source to know the social challenges of the region.
Okay. And you're from Madhya Pradesh, and the Chhattisgarh was carved out of Madhya Pradesh and made it as a state, and it is almost 20 years now. Now it's a 20 years is a significant period to analyze the progress or otherwise whether it has met the objective or not. Like, can you please throw some light on it, like whether it has met the aspirations of the people of Chhattisgarh or it's still the work in progress?
Sir, may I call in 5 minutes, sir?
So the division into Chhattisgarh, it has helped in fulfilling the political aspirations of the people of Chhattisgarh. While it was a part of Madhya Pradesh, the positions of chief minister would rarely go to the people of that region. So political aspirations now are being better fulfilled. Sir, targeted focus now, since Chhattisgarh has many marginalized communities, so targeted focus has resulted in improvement in social and health indicators. But at the same time, certain issues like tribal extremism in Chhattisgarh is still prevalent. And grassroots development has not taken place, especially with respect to economic indicators.
Okay. And you are from Madhya Pradesh, and it is having one of the largest forest in the country, and how was it performed in ensuring the implementation?
Pardon, sir?
Okay, I'm sorry, I don't know, I think there is some signal issue from my side. Okay, I'm repeating, like how far the Madhya Pradesh has performed in the implementation of Forest Rights Act actually?
Sir, Forest Rights Act has been has received mixed response in Madhya Pradesh. Certain tribal groups and forest dwellers who were in possession of their ownership rights have been able to benefit. Those who were dislocated from their places of dwelling from forests, especially in the Anuppur Shahdol region, which is coal rich, they are yet to get benefits of this act. So tribes who have had their ownership rights, especially in the forest rich regions, they have benefited, but some of them have not.
Okay. Earlier you were working under public sector undertaking. What is your opinion about share is coming down, and now you are more towards handing over all the projects towards the investment mode? What's your call on that?
Sir, will you please repeat, sir?
I think some problem with your audio.
Mr. Pandiraj, I think you can switch off your video so that your audio would be with a better.
Yes, yes. Like, am I audible?
Yeah, now it's better.
Jakrati?
Yes, sir.
Okay,
yes, sir.
Fine. Okay, and Jakrati, like, my question was, like, you earlier worked in the PSU, public sector undertaking. Like, what is your opinion about disinvestment of there is a trend that is being, we can observe it. More disinvestment is being resorted to cover up the revenue deficit. Like, what is your call on it? Like, is it a right trend, or like we should continue disinvestment, or we should retain the stake in all this public sector undertakings?
Your voice is breaking, Pandira sir. It's not continuous and clear.
It's not, yeah. I think there's some problem with your audio, Pandira. It doesn't matter. I think we can now...
Okay.
So,
yes, sir, yes, sir.
Yeah.
I'll look into that. I'm done, sir.
Okay, thank you. So, Jagriti, we just give you a little feedback, Jagriti, based on... Can you hear me, Jagriti?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'll just give you some feedback. I think you've done very well. You come out as a very intelligent, smart young person. And I don't see any reason why you should not get more than 60-65% in the interview. So the important thing is to see how you can go beyond that, you know, to 70-75%. So, you know, one of the questions, an easy one is, why do you want to get into the IAS? You know, this is there are enough... answers to this, but you have to have something that makes it impactful, no? So I think one of the things, strong things that you have is you have an engineering background. So you should clearly say that today the entire governance is going on the internet, on digital, on technology. And this is where I can make a great difference because, and I think 60-70% are online, on government, there are using of AI, big data. You should constantly give an imprint that you have a tech edge, which would, you know, you have said it, but you have to articulate that technology edge. And on women's issues, you should read up a little so that that is again a question that you can crack, you know, on the kind of things. And when you are asked a thing about somewhere, you must also bring in the thing about your little experience and in the rural areas. You must have spent some time in the rural areas, like you said, Bundelkhand. So you must say that this gave you an exposure to the underprivileged, to the people there, the women's, their issues. And I had a desire that if I get into service, I would be able to do something there. So these two, three, this is more a very subtle PR, but which will go down well with these people. So this is just a few tips, which I find that is very important. To get the right thing. Okay. So these are, otherwise you are good to go. You are just read up the general knowledge things and all the usual foreign policy things, which will keep coming up. Taliban, this China, this that, the usual ones.
Yes,
but
sir.
Try to go behind the news. What is happening, everybody knows. But some discussion on that, some conversation on that, on foreign policy, what is happening and all that. Try to be conversationalist. That's
yes,
it. Yes, Professor Narasimhan.
Thank you, sir. Jagriti, I think one of the plus points is you are very cheerful. So I think that should add to your performance. And you have answered most of the questions very well, except in your own subject area where you need to probably brush up a little more.
Yes, sir.
With regard to the basics, right? And what I asked is a very basic one. So you should brush up a little more. And I think with that, probably you should be able to do very well. All the best.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I think you will do very well and wish you all the best, Agathe.
Thank you, sir.